You've heard of disposable cameras. You've heard of disposable diapers. How about disposable movies? For this video to make any sense, I'm going to need you to imagine a world in which Netflix, Amazon Prime Video, Disney Plus, trying to future-proof here, and all those other streaming services don't exist. It's a desolate landscape, I know, but thankfully, video rental stores existed to help you through these trying times. And, well, actually Netflix did exist at this point, but they were still only mailing DVDs to you. How quaint. But you know what's annoying about video rental stores? You have to take the disc back to them. Or mail it back. What a hassle! I mean, needing to go back to the store and giving them the thing which I borrowed back? How inconvenient! I mean, it's not like I'm gonna just go back and rent another thing. Now I have to go out of my way to return my copy of Shrek 2. Ugh. But what if there were a way that I could rent a movie and not have to bring it back? Don't you mean buy the movie? No, I mean what if I could somehow bring home a DVD which will only work for 2 days after I open it, and then it breaks itself. All the savings of renting with the convenience of buying. I'll take 600! This rather bizarre idea did actually happen. It wasn't a huge success, and I'm gonna argue that's probably a good thing, but in the early 2000s there was an idea to put a clever spin on optical disc technology. Some of you might be thinking of DivX, an earlier modification of DVD by Circuit City, which was a more technical solution involving special players that phoned in to a central server to verify whether any specific disc could be played or not. You could then upgrade your disc at an additional charge to be playable after the rental period, or even upgrade it to a so-called DivX Silver Disc, at which point you effectively owned that title. Ain't that some dystopian DRM right there? But we're not talking about that. Instead, we're talking about something else. After DivX had proven itself a failure, a little company called Flexplay Technologies decided to try that concept again and began to market what they initially called EZDs. These were completely compliant DVDs that would work in any DVD player, but that were made with a chemical component that would effectively destroy the disc after 2 days of being exposed to oxygen. The idea was that you could buy these discs in a store for about the cost of a rental, and since they were sealed in airtight packaging, they wouldn't break down until you decided to watch it. You could then watch the film an unlimited amount of times within 48 hours, after which point the disc would blacken and become unreadable. And of course, I have one of these discs right here. It almost certainly does not work, but we will try it just in case. That's right, I haven't opened this yet. We're gonna do it together. I moved you a bit closer so we can do this together. What's that doing here? Anyway, let's open the package. I'm using a knife like a responsible person. I'm cutting towards me. So this is just very basic paper packaging in shrink wrap. Very user-friendly. And inside we find a little package with some information. And our disc. This might possibly work, but we will see. This is really, I will say, you would need scissors to open this. Ah. Or some sharp object like the utility knife. So it looks like a normal DVD, except the back of it is a very dark red color. This may work. Which would be surprising, but we'll find out. I can't see the TV, so we're just gonna see what happens. It's making really weird noises. I'm gonna guess it's not working. Let's try it again. This is nerve-wracking. I don't think it's working. I just noticed this for best results opened by April 2009, which is great because that was inside the shrink wrap, so there's no way you could really well, I suppose on the shelf it wouldn't matter, but if you took this home, you better open at least this far to get a sense of when you need to watch this. We appear to be getting nowhere fast. This is attempt two. It really sounds like it's trying its best. Wait, did it get somewhere? I have to actually look at the screen. I can't stand this. What's very interesting to me is that the player hasn't given an error. It's just continuously trying to play it. So it's almost like it can see something, but not enough to matter. Well, that was an expected disappointment. Since the disc is so old, oxygen has seeped through its packaging and has already destroyed the disc. In fact, the disc's only had a shelf life of about a year. if we were in 2008 or whenever this disc was made, we would have seen a bright red disc. And it would have, you know, worked. Now you might think that the red coloring is the special compound which turns black, but it isn't. Instead, it's a weirdly forward-thinking countermeasure against them newfangled Blu-ray players they're talking about. See, the black color isn't actually black. Light of certain wavelengths could pass through it, much like how infrared light passes right through the black coloring of a PlayStation disc. And one of those wavelengths that could pass through this is the blue-violet found in the laser of a Blu-ray disc player. Coloring the disc itself red would block that blue light, so even if someone can manage to read DVD data using a blue laser, which, for the record, isn't very easy at all and is why Blu-ray players have a red laser diode too for reading DVDs, their attempt would be foiled. Are you wondering why I keep calling this black when it's clearly a cherry red? Well, to make filming easier, I filmed the written portion before I actually opened the disc. Yep, it was movie magic. Descriptions and images of these discs show that they literally turn black, like a PlayStation disc, but this disc clearly hasn't. This is why I thought there was a chance the disc may have worked when I first opened it. Either its packaging was somehow able to prevent the disc from turning completely black in the 11 years between its manufacture and today, or describing it as blackening was simply hyperbole, and in fact, it just got darker. If the disc does turn completely black in the coming days, I'll let you know and provide some pictures in a pinned comment. Well, links to pictures, but you know what I mean. So let's talk about what this disc was actually trying to accomplish. When you or I go to a store and buy a DVD or Blu-ray disc, we're not really buying the movie. Instead, we're buying a specific license to watch that content in a private setting for the rest of time. Or at least, for the life of the disc, videotape, or whatever media contains it. That's what the FBI is always warning you about. You didn't buy a license to show this in theaters. You didn't buy a license to share this on YouTube. You bought one license to watch this one film in your home for your own enjoyment. But you can watch it over and over again, and once you buy it, you'll never have to buy it again. Unless, of course, you get tired of watching it on VHS and want to upgrade to some newer format or whatever. The cost of making the packaging and the disc itself is almost nothing. DVDs cost pennies to make, but the movie is expensive because of the terms of the license you're buying. If whoever the content owner is can only make money from you once and then possibly never again, they're gonna charge a lot for the option to outright own the rights to private viewing indefinitely. But if there's a set time limit on your enjoyment of the film, then the movie studio doesn't have to charge nearly as much. If they have the opportunity to sell it to you again down the road, they won't mind if they only make a few bucks. So, what Flexplay and DivX before it attempted to do was to sell only temporary rights to a film, and thus movie studios would only charge Flexplay a couple bucks per disc, rather than 10 or 20. And since DVDs are hilariously cheap to make, Flexplay could simply sell you these discs for the cost of a rental, about $5, and all parties involved would make their buck. The advantage of Flexplay, of course, was that you needn't bother returning to the place you bought it. The disc would simply become unusable, and you could toss it out. Now, while this may seem like a pretty stupid idea, after all, video rental stores already existed, so what's the real advantage aside from enabling even lazier habits? It could have been pretty revolutionary. Flexplay wasn't just trying to make a consumer's life easier, they were trying to enable any business to easily get into the video rental market. Video stores like Blockbuster needed lots of square footage of retail space to maintain their inventories. They needed to track rentals and charge late fees, and in general, their business was rather unique. A grocery store probably isn't going to want to take on all those hassles just to make a few extra bucks. But since FlexPlay didn't require you to return anything, stores could simply sell them like any other product. Any retail establishment, from grocery stores to gas stations to office supply stores to hardware stores, could easily get into the video rental market. Simply set up a FlexPlay display, order some movies to sell, and watch your profits soar! Except, of course, that didn't really happen, did it? FlexPlay discs were first tested in 2003 with a small handful of Disney titles, and the test was a resounding failure. First of all, let's be honest, this is a weird product. You'd think that the failure of DivX would have been a warning that this ain't gonna work. And even in 2003, Billboard was skeptical of the product and thought it would create a lot of market confusion. They were pretty correct, as the test ran for only a year before the product was pulled. A large part of why it failed was due to pressure from environmental groups. Disposable DVDs don't sound like a great product to catch on. While it is of course possible to recycle the discs, for the test run Flexplay didn't seem to be that interested in figuring that part out. And of course, needing to return to the store where you bought it to recycle the disc kinda defeats the purpose. The convenience aspect, sold both to the business that sells them and to the consumer that buys them, is pretty much lost if the consumer is expected to return and the business has to handle the recycling. So what's the point? Disney is likely who caused the end of the trial, as environmental groups were pressuring them to stop this Flexplay nonsense. And they did, for rather obvious PR reasons. But Flexplay would return with a vengeance in 2008. They had somehow managed to get Paramount, Warner Brothers, Starz, and New Line Cinema to agree to licensing deals, and they also convinced Love's Travel Centers, Hudson News, Travel Centers of America, and, notably, Staples to sell their discs. Apparently, they were trying to go after the business traveler who wanted to rent a movie, but was too busy to return it. Or something like that. To try and alleviate concerns from the environmentally minded, they partnered with a company that recycles techno-trash to provide recycling bins at places that sold the discs. Which again, defeats the purpose. And they also would allow you to print out a free shipping label to return the disc for recycling. Which again, defeats the point. And now you've printed something to ship it back to be destroyed. Apparently, Flexplay did offer free return labels during the original trial run, but really, the whole thing did seem rather stupid. If you're gonna mail it back, you might as well use Netflix and the disc can then be enjoyed by dozens of people. Rather than one. If you have to return to the store, you might as well go to a video store and rent it there. Or you can just throw it out and be okay with the wasted plastic. And then, of course, there's this little company. Ah yes, that one. The product that lets retail establishments get into the video rental business without taking on any of the hassle, which allows its customers to return the rentals to any of the machines which are purposely placed in front of everyday businesses to maximize convenience. The product that costs a small fraction to use compared to buying a Flexplay disc, with only a small convenience penalty, or if you were of the mind to recycle your Flexplay disc, no convenience penalty at all. But I'm sure Flexplay will do just fine. Well, it didn't. At a cost of $4.99 to $5.99, the product didn't make sense at all. Remember that Netflix discs were only $10 a month at this point, and that was for an unlimited number of rentals. Well, unlimited aside for the turnaround time of mailing it back. As long as you rented just two things in a month, Netflix comes at the same cost or less of Flexplay. And of course, you could keep the disc for a week and not, you know, find that it destroyed itself. Redbox rentals were still $1 per day, so if you wanted to go that route, you could rent a movie for one-fifth the cost of a Flexplay title. And thanks to their positioning in front of convenience and grocery stores, you would probably have a reason to go back and return it anyway. Plus, Redbox does give the retail establishment a commission for letting them use the space for a machine. So regardless of how icky throwaway polycarbonate frisbees may seem to you from a waste perspective, it also, frankly, just doesn't make sense at all. Flexplay was pretty much the worst possible way to rent a movie at the time. If, perhaps, things went to their plans and loads of bored business travelers stuck in airports decided to pop for a movie from Hudson News, then maybe this would have worked. But I just don't think that was really a viable market to begin with. If it was, you'd think Redbox would be in airports, since you could just return the disc when you get home. But maybe they didn't want to deal with the logistics of discs routinely going cross-country or something, I don't know. Pretty much the one sole advantage that you could say Flexplay legitimately had was that the disc would be brand new every time. You'd never have to worry about a scratched rental disc refusing to play and then the hassle of returning it and getting a refund. But this concept was already tried with DivX and people didn't like it at all. Yes, DivX was a weird product that wasn't even compatible with DVD players, so at least Flexplay had that going for it. But the resounding failure of DivX was somehow brushed off by those pushing Flexplay, and honestly, they should have seen this coming. I'll grant it's clever, and I remember hearing about it and thinking it was pretty neat. But for a commodity like video rental, a neat gimmick means a lot less than a practical, inexpensive rental. And that's before we even get into the waste aspect. Sure, the production and disposal of an individual DVD probably has a teeny tiny environmental impact, but the tragedy of the commons means that as more people do it, the worse it gets, and possibly without realizing it. If Flexplay had become mainstream, then imagine a world in which 70 million households were renting one movie per month. That's over 800 million DVDs produced each year in the US alone, all of which will be intentionally wasted if made by Flexplay. In 2010, Redbox rented over 500 million discs. According to this website I found, the average disc is rented 15 times, so those 500 million rentals were only made of about 33 million discs. Redbox accounted for nearly half the rental market around this time, so assuming similar numbers across the board, conventional DVD rental would require about 66 million discs per year versus 1 billion FlexPlay discs. Yikes. So I think it's safe to say it's a good thing FlexPlay kind of fizzled. Yes, there are probably a few billion blank DVD-Rs floating around that will never be used, but they weren't meant to just be tossed. Producing a DVD with a deliberately limited lifespan seems pretty, well, of poor taste. And I think that while we seem to live in a convenience-driven economy, there is a line that seems rather crass. And I think FlexPlay crossed it. Interestingly, a thought experiment has been floating around wondering if the environmental impact of streaming services, with their vast amount of hard drives and servers running 24/7 sucking up that sweet, sweet electricity, might actually be worse for the Earth's health than physical media. In many ways, streaming services are the perfect candidate for a tragedy of the commons scenario, because we can't see the backbones that make them work. But regardless, I think we can agree that producing tons of single-use DVDs is definitely worse than simply renting them out the old-fashioned way. Before I close this video out, I'd like to discuss the patent. The patent that I believe is the principal one owned by FlexPlay is incredible. Their patent was so broad that it covered basically any potential way to create a self-destructing disc. Here are just a few samplings. In one embodiment, the invention includes an optical disc on which the metallic layer containing the data is not completely protected from the ambient environment. Another aspect of the invention is a mechanical device which sets in motion a timed destruction of the data when the optical disc is removed from the packaging. Alternatively, a timed destruction of the data can be triggered by electric current or charge provided by a small battery, or simply the energy released when the disc is removed from the package. They basically thought up as many ways to achieve a self-destructing disc as they could and wrapped them all up into an overarching patent. Pretty smart, actually. In fact, it can best be summed up in this one paragraph. Another aspect of the invention is a composition comprising a degradable optical disc as described in this section, packaged in an enclosure and atmosphere that protects it from the environmental stimulus that causes its failure. For example, the optical disc described above could be packaged in a metallized foil package containing a gas such as carbon dioxide, nitrogen, or argon. The pressure of gases in the package can be subatmospheric, preferably less than 1 torr. Inert gases such as argon are preferred. This would serve to protect the optical disc from oxygen, water, and/or light of certain wavelengths. They even described a disc that would be chemically altered from the light of the laser reading the disc, which could in theory limit the disc to a certain number of plays, and not a specific time frame. They really did cover all their bases here. Too bad it was a product nobody asked for. As always, thank you to everyone who supports this channel on Patreon, especially the fine folks you see scrolling up your screen. Contributions from individuals like you are what make Technology Connections possible. If you'd like to make a pledge of your own and get perks like early video access, occasional behind-the-scenes footage, and the inside scoop on the latest projects, please check out my Patreon page. Thanks for your consideration, and I'll see you next time. I will be amazed if this works, and I hope it doesn't because I already recorded what I did earlier, so let's try. Was to sell only temporary rights to a film and is pretty much lost if the consumer is expected. Is very hard because that's not the line. Loads of bored business travelers stuck in. I've completely forgot how I wrote this line. We appear to be getting nowhere fast.